Hello and welcome to lecture 7 on Traffic Dynamics and Simulation Master's course. In this lesson we will talk about models with a dynamic speed equation, also called second order models, because we have two dynamic equations. What is the reason to do this? The LBR, like with Richard's model of lecture 6, do not contain a dynamic speed. Rather, the speed is statically coupled to the density via the fundamental diagram. This means LBR models cannot display traffic flow instabilities, which typically arise because at a certain density, the speed can take on other values than the steady state value. That means it is truly dynamic. In this lecture, we'll only consider a subset of the provided slides. Notice that only what is in this lecture is relevant for the examination. So we start with giving the general mathematical form. We will see that similarly to the wheel conservation equation, there are also some restrictions just because the acceleration should be given in the co-moving frame of reference. That means the Lagrange system. Then we will give some plausibility criteria of the acceleration function, which will be the only variable function with which to distinguish the different models. We will only shortly speak about ramp terms, not about the math, that's not part of the examination, and we will only investigate a single of the specific models. And we will not discuss the numerics in this year and in this lecture. So let's start with displaying traffic flow instabilities and why the LBR models cannot show it. For this, I use my simulator at traffic-simulation.de, namely the ring road scenario. After starting, I will click on an arbitrary vehicle introducing a small perturbation. So this is a small perturbation. So the LBR model would just permanently update this small perturbation without changing it, without increasing its amplitude. And what does the real traffic do? It develops a traffic flow instability under certain conditions. So the small perturbation develops into a full traffic wave. LBR models cannot show this. Of course, LBR models could, once given the initial condition here, just permanently propagate this jam. So they can propagate existing jam, and they can also simulate breakdown situations just arising because the demand is higher than the capacity. But that's the only situation where LBR models can introduce jam, not with traffic instabilities. That's why we now go over to the macroscopic models of second order. By the way, later we will of course consider also this model, which can be simulated so nicely here. But that is in the next and in the next to the next lesson ahead. Let's start with the general mathematical form of second order models. Because they are second order, they have, in addition to the LBR models, an own speed equation. That means the fundamental diagram, or more precisely the speed density relation, is replaced by a true dynamic speed relation. There are two formulations, the local formulation and the non-local formulation. This looks complicated, but the terms can be easily calculated, and particularly they are useful to see what really can be changed and what is just given by the by conservation laws and by some general consideration. Notice that because the continuity equation just reflects the conservation of real numbers, it of course is also valid for second order models. So this is just a new second dynamic equation. So let's look at the terms. The first term on the right hand side is just the acceleration from the driver's point of view. That means the Lagrangian formulation. The next term is the traffic pressure. It just reflects statistical effects. So this does not reflect any true acceleration. We will learn how this can happen just in a moment. Finally, the acceleration function or functional is the only thing that is really a variable and that distinguishes the different macroscopic models, second order, one from each other. If it's local, it's just a function of the density of the speed, that means a local speed field, V from X and T. It also contains at least one derivative, that means this function also depends on the gradient of the density, may also depend on the gradient of the speed, and maybe also on second derivatives. However, at least one gradient is necessary, otherwise that can be shown, but we will not show here. The model is unconditional, unstable numerically. It will just explode numerically. And also in the real sense, because this just means there is zero anticipation. Drivers do not look even at the vehicle in front, and that of course by force will lead to accidents. So let's add the single terms in more detail. First, the acceleration in the driver's frame of reference. Let's look at this a point that is along the trajectory, along this trajectory, and look how the speed field, that is the red shades, changes when moving along the trajectory. First, of course, there is the partial derivative with respect to time. Here, time, remember, time is horizontal. This partial derivative is zero, but this partial derivative is trivial. It would just also happen in the stationary point of view if, for example, a moving jam traffic wave propagates through the system. Here we do not have such a traffic wave, but just a stationary speed profile. For example, it may be that here's a bottleneck and here the vehicles are slow, jammed, and here they pass a bottleneck and accelerate. However, in the moving frame of reference, we have another term indicating that the speed not only changes at a given position temporally, but also the speed gradients come into play because the driver just moves at a new region, and just by because of the spatial speed gradients, we get another speed. So this is this term of the speed change here. That means the speed gradient times the position, the displacement. And then of course we want to replace this dx by dt, so that we have a common differential, and that of course is just by extending this dv dx by dv dx times dx dt times dt. And dx dt of course is the local speed. In summary, we have just dv equals this substantive derivative, also called convective derivative, times dt. That means the total derivative dV with a straight d, dV divided by dt just gives this acceleration. So this is the acceleration in the moving frame of reference. So particularly this term does not indicate any true acceleration. It's just because we move to other regions. So even without own acceleration, this would also be present. Now we want to look at the pressure term. Remember the pressure term, that was this term. Interestingly, this is also a purely statistical effect. There's not any acceleration involved, although on the left-hand side there is this substantial derivative. So that's why also I included this pressure gradient also in the substantial derivative, because it also applies if not a single vehicle accelerates. How can we visualize this? So assume first this above situation, two lanes. On the right hand lane, all vehicles are slower than on the left hand lane. But all vehicles on each lane have always a constant speed. The red vehicles have a higher constant speed. They have a density gradient, but a constant speed. And the blue vehicles have a lower speed. And the macroscopic speed is just the local average. For example, let's just average over this hatched region. When we have two red and two blue vehicles, that means we have a local speed of V1 plus V2 half. Now let's propagate in time. The hatched region moves with a local speed forward. That's covered by the convective derivative of the speed. So far, so good. However, relative to the movement of this hatched region, the red vehicles move faster. That means this pair is now here. And the blue vehicles move slower. That means this pair is now here. So the back vehicle is no more in the hatched region. So remember, not a single vehicle accelerates. Still, in the new hatched region, where we have two red vehicles and only one blue vehicle, while here we have two red and two blue, that means the average local average here is more dominated by the red vehicles and is therefore higher, because the red vehicles have double local speed. Here we have 2v2 plus v1 third. That means if the density gradient is negative, gradient is of course in the x direction, high density, high average, low density, and there is a speed variance, then this leads to another additional term increasing the speed. And that's, if we go back to this term, pressure term, that is particularly this pressure term. This pressure term is a function of the density, that basically this contains a speed gradient here. So if the speed gradient is negative, we get a positive acceleration. Remember, this is the true local Lagrange acceleration. We need to put this other hand side with a minus sign. That means the sign is correct, exactly how this figure shows. That means we have a macroscopic change of speed, it does not reflect any car acceleration. Finally, we come to discussing the true acceleration. That is the acceleration which the vehicles really do and which distinguish the different models from each other. What are possible reasons for an acceleration? The first one is, as I said, the speed, the local speed must no longer lie on the fundamental diagram or on the local steady state, but it can be higher or lower. If the speed is higher than would be the steady state for a given density, that, for example, means that you are driving too close, because with a driving a higher speed at a given density, the time gap is too low, you should brake. If, however, you have a too low speed, then you obstruct other vehicles, then you should accelerate. And the acceleration increases with the distance from the steady state a point. That means with this distance. This is what you want to reach, steady state. This is the actual speed. If actual speed is slower, then this term is positive. And this is just the relaxation time. That is the typical time you need to reach your desired new speed. Of course, you approach it exponentially if everything else is constant. So this is just an order of magnitude. Particularly, this whole term indicates a sort of acceleration, speed difference by relaxation time. So that's one reason for accelerating or decelerating. Can you think of another reason? Consider that not only you need not only to look at your local density, but also you need to look ahead, because that's what matters for your whether you crash soon into your front vehicle or not. So you need to look ahead. Let's do this. One way to do this macroscopically is to just look at the density ahead, and maybe also on the density. The density ahead can be lower, can be higher. This is the density, and if it's higher, the steady state speed at this anticipated location is lower, and then you can just use the same mechanisms and say, oh, well, I should brake because otherwise I would crash into these slower vehicles. At least I should brake down to the steady state speed when I have just steady state flow at a lower speed. Likewise, I would do if ahead vehicles are faster, for example, when leaving a jam, then because the front vehicle also will accelerate, I can just accelerate. That means that gives positive anticipative acceleration. In the general way, this looks like this. We have just density gradients and speed gradients. So the density gradient is this positive, then the acceleration should be a negative contribution, that means gamma 1 is negative. However, the speed gradient is positive, that means vehicle ahead are driving faster, then I can accelerate as well. So gamma 2 would be positive. A particularly easy and straightforward realization of this gradients and the motivation of density gradients would be just to take this figure here literally. That means use the normal speed relaxation, but at a non-local position. The corresponding question is, give an expression when anticipation of a relaxation process at a certain point, for example, at this point, and give a corresponding expression. First, it's just the relaxation, VE, steady state minus speed divided by relaxation time, only that the argument is not at x, but at an anticipated location xa. And if this anticipated location is a distance 1 over rho, that means that a typical vehicle distance headway ahead, then we can just replace the anticipated density by the local density. plus the derivative of this whole thing with respect to x, according to a chain rule, is with the gradient of a steady state. Then we need to take the derivative of the density, and then this delta x equals 1 over rho, that just gives this. That means just using the anticipated relaxation gives a term of this sort with gamma 1 given by the gradient of the steady state speed times 1 over rho. And because the gradient is negative, that means this gamma 1 is negative, as it should be, because if higher densities ahead, I should break. While some sort of gradients is necessary in order to not have a completely unstable system, both numerically and in reality, we need these gradients. However, these gradients hardly suppress the shock waves from the first order model. Because remember, the continuity equation leading to the shock waves is also part of the second order models. Maybe the anticipation softens it a little bit, but often this steeping mechanism of the shock wave overcomes this anticipation. So we still have this unwanted shock waves. How can we get rid of them? There are two possibilities. The more straightforward for numerically more complicated is just to add a diffusion term. That means a second speed derivative in the speed and equation. And this works always, but it has other unwanted properties, and also it has unfavorable numerical properties, which requiring a very short update time, making the models numerically unstable and slow. A better way is to use the anticipation directly, not using this detour over the Taylor expansion and gradients, but just directly entering a non-local quantity on the right-hand side of the acceleration. This gets rid of all gradients, makes my model numerically faster. Mathematically, analytically, it's a nightmare, but this doesn't matter because numerically it's easy and straightforward to compute, and it's pretty fast. Not so fast as the first order models, but it also has more dynamics. So let's look at the non-local models. The left-hand side is the same. That is just all terms which include the real acceleration. So that's the partial change with time, the change due to moving in new directions, and the change to density gradients and kinematic effects. On the right hand side is the true acceleration of the drivers. Instead of the gradients, the rho dx and dv dx and so on, we have now, besides rho and v, just the density and the local speed at an anticipated location. So rho anticipated is just the density field at an anticipated location, xa greater x, and the same for the anticipated speed. That means non-local models contain forward-looking explicitly. So we can use easy numerical differentiation using only the upstream information. Why? Because of the forward-looking, the downstream information is contained automatically. And the right-hand side can also be written just as a generalized relaxation, speed relaxation at some non-local point. As I said already, you need not to go into very detail with respect to the second order models, but you should know about the plausibility criteria for the acceleration function. That means for the right hand side. For simplicity, I've here neglected the pressure term and just on the left hand side put the normal Lagrange acceleration. That means the acceleration as seen from the moving vehicles. That means the true acceleration the driver does. And we have seen in local models, it's just a function of the density, the speed field, and its gradient. In non-local models, we have replaced the gradients by density and speed at some anticipated positions. Now, there must be some plausibility criteria. The first is if the speed argument, which is in both forms, increases, the acceleration should decrease. Why is this so? That's obvious. If everything else keeps constant, density keeps constant, density gradients or the density at anticipated locations, then of course, if I have a higher speed, either my acceleration is less or my braking is stronger. So these two conditions should apply for all plausible models. Now let's look at the next point. Response to local density. If density ahead is higher, that means I need to brake. And also this is the case here, that means higher density means either accelerating less or braking more. Interesting is a homogeneous steady state. In most models, we have a clearly defined steady state relation for any speed or for any densities. There is a corresponding steady state density or steady state speed. That is reflected by this implicit relation. If I change simultaneously the density and the speed, then I can keep the acceleration of zero. So it means the steady state is just defined if I put this the driver's acceleration to zero or this to zero, then the arguments implicitly define the steady state relation. That means the fundamental diagram, the speed density diagram. So that's pretty cute. So that means this fundamental diagram is just contained in this function. If, for example, I take this, then I have just a function containing v and rho. That means I can solve it at least theoretically for the speed. So I have a speed density relation, and this should obey the typical steady state relation condition at a density zero, the maximum speed, desired speed v zero, the gradient less or equal zero, equal is allowed here, and at the maximum density, the local speed must be zero. How it looks at a non-local case. Steady state just means the density at the non-local position is the same as here, and here the same as here. Again, this is an implicit equation for a relation steady state as a function of rho. And why is this? That's clear. That's evident. V0 is maximum speed at maximum density, zero speed, and decreasing in between. However, there are more plausibility criteria, because as I said, we need also some anticipation, either in the form of gradients. Let's assume there's a positive density gradient ahead, then the acceleration should go to negative values, to lower values, less positive or more negative, and that is defined by this gradient. Notice that rho x is just a shorthand notation for the gradient of density with respect to x. The same here is the shorthand notation for the speed gradient with respect to x. If vehicles ahead are faster, one can accelerate. That means when this term is positive, my increased density is negative. And quite analog the non-localities, we can just replace gradient by the anticipated location, the density of anticipated location, speed and anticipated location. So these are the five plausibility criteria. Let's now come to the ramp term, which we will, as I said, only treat very shortly, and it's not really examination relevant, but just for knowing, as I said, the continuum equation is always valid. That means it's all the ramp terms of a continuum equation are always valid. However, this is only the only term if the speed at the ramp is the same as on the main road. Typically, the speed at the ramp is slower, and that applies both for the on-ramp, because one typically changes to the main road without having reached the full main road speed, but it also occurs to the off-ramp, because one typically brakes already on the main road before changing lane to the off-ramp and leaving the road. And basically, one can also consider this in the moving and driver's point of view. So that is the Eulerian view of a stationary observer, where the ramp vehicles just enter, of course, with positive speed. However, from the point of view of a driver, the ramp vehicles are slower. That means they drive backwards with respect to the driver. And this is the case both for on-ramps and for off-ramps. That means that gives an addition deceleration term for the speed. However, as the kinematic terms, the pressure, this deceleration does not mean that any main road vehicle decelerates, but just that the population of the vehicles contains more slow ramp vehicles. So it's another kinematic effect. That's more or less the only thing you need to know for the ramp terms, additional ramp terms for the second order models. As a derivation, it's quite interesting and instructive, but we will not go into detail here. Lastly, we will present one specific model. It's probably the simplest one, a Payne's model. In the lecture slides, there are also other models, but they are not really relevant for the examination. Still, they are interesting, but I don't want to overburden you. So just this model, it already looks complicated, but in reality, it's pretty simple, as we will see. Let's analyze it. First, on the left-hand side, there's this typical acceleration from the driver's point of view. On the right-hand side, we have just the classical speed relaxation V to the steady state speed, VE, with a relaxation time tau. It has the, as model parameters, the relaxation time tau, and all the model parameters which are in this steady state relation, steady state speed is a function of rho. This steady state speed can be triangular or have any form. That means Payne's model is also a whole model class parameterized by the different steady state speed relations, just as is the case for the LVR model. However, with only these terms, the model would be numerically unstable, so we need at least one term containing gradients or anticipations. Payne's model is classically in, so it contains a gradient. before deriving it, I want just to make sure that you understand why the homogeneous state is equal to the steady state relation. What does homogeneous state mean? Homogeneous means no space gradients. That means this term drops out and also this term drops out. Steady state also means stationary. That means also time derivatives drop out. So we have just left with 0 equals Ve minus V divided by tau. Tau is a positive quantity, so you can multiply it by it. That means just we have Ve minus V equals 0. That of course means steady state is reached if and only if the speed obeys this functional relation, which therefore is the steady state speed density relation, which is one of the way you can write the fundamental diagram. How does the density gradient come from? That can, according to my standard mechanism, anticipation mechanism, can be derived from just anticipation. And the anticipation is given by half the distance headway between the vehicles. Because half, so that means the drivers just look in the gap in between the own vehicle and the leading vehicle in order to assess the situation at the ahead of him. That means we can just Taylor expand this anticipation density. The zero of order term is just the steady state. Then we have a speed, steady state speed gradient. Then we need chain rule density gradient, and then anticipated location and delta x half. And this delta x half we can replace by 1 over 2 rho, giving the term which is just here. It's just this term, of course, divided by tau, the relaxation time. You can also write a density gradient in form of a pressure term, but here this would be misleading because pressure term means there's just speed change because of kinematic reasons. Here, however, the speed change is because of anticipation. That means there's a true acceleration, vehicle acceleration involved. This model is nice because it's only a single parameter besides this in the fundamental diagram. So it has only one parameter more than the LVR model. And SVLVR, I said already, this Payne's model is a whole model class, depending on which fundamental diagram you choose. Particularly, you can choose a triangular fundamental diagram. This was a rather short lecture on macroscopic models of second order, which can also describe traffic flow instabilities. However, in most cases, it's best to use a microscopic approach. That means just to consider the vehicles individually, as you have already seen in my simulator, trafficmindsimulation.de. That will be the topic of the next two or three lectures. So stay tuned.